Hi folks, it's great to see you here again. Today, I would like to talk about something you must know. Something that is a matter of life and eternal damnation. You need to know this so you will not fall in the trap of the devil, unlike many other people who will be judged for what they did because they didn't know what they are doing or who they are supporting. Because many people today are supporting an organization that is from Satan, and its aim is to build up a satanic new world order, and in the middle of it, a satanic temple for devil worship. And now I'm talking about Zionism. This is what we're going to talk about today, and also the difference between Satan's Zionism and God's covenant on Mount Sion. Now, this video goes out to all the people who are not afraid to question the lies that they have been taught in their false churches, and are willing to make an effort and do their research and discover the real truth behind these religious movements that are in the world today. So you can choose whether you want to find out the real painful truth behind these movements and also to find the precious truths of God, or you can go to the church and listen to your highly trained Jesuit Freemason pastors who are paid to mislead you and to lead you away from the gates of the kingdom of God. So, let's begin from the very beginning so you will understand this more easily. On the outside, Zionism looks like a normal modern-day movement, which wants to create a home for the Jewish people. And it's okay because these modern-day Khazar Jews are scattered and they really don't have a home. So, like I said, from the outside, this whole movement looks all okay. But in fact, if you look at it closer and do your research, you will see that there is something wrong with it. First of all, it's not biblical, because the prophecies of the Bible, which they refer to, were not about the physical Jews. Secondly, if you examine this whole movement, and especially the people who created it, you will quickly realize that it's all just a lie to cover a secret plan. And the truth is, Zionism is a fake movement, and the only purpose of it is to make the people, especially the Christians, believe that the nation of Israel, which was established in 1948, is a legitimate state in the eyes of God, and that the prophecies come true right before our eyes. So once the Christians and the rest of the world believes this, they will accept the third temple, which will be built in Israel in the next couple of years, and also the Antichrist, who will disguise himself as Christ who returned. So as you probably understand by now, this recording has a significant meaning because today we're going to expose the real secret plan behind Zionism. And it's very important for you to understand that this whole movement is not from God, and therefore you should not take part in it and you should not support it with money or prayers. Now, in order to understand what Zionism is, we first have to examine the real plan behind it. And in the following 30 minutes, we're gonna run through a historical timeline in which I will highlight some of the meaningful events and some other important information that is necessary to understand what we are talking about. The basic idea behind the cover of Zionism is thousands of years old, and it came from Satan and not from God. This satanic idea is none other than the New World Order. And this idea, this goal to build up a new world order, is in fact from the devil himself. The Freemasons and the Jesuits and all the secret societies who have created Zionism and who are now preparing the world for a new world order, and these are just the minions of Satan, because he is the one who planned this concept, and these people and organizations are just executors who have been deceived by him. And believe it or not, this is actually what the Bible says. The scripture clearly exposes the plan of Satan. As you probably know from the Bible, in the heavenly kingdom of our Father, there was an angel, a cherub, called Lucifer. This Lucifer was with God, and he was in the presence of God all the time. He saw the glory and the everlasting kingdom of God just like the other cherubim with him. And his heart was lifted up, and he started to look at his own glory instead of the glory of our Father. So, as this went on, he started to worship himself, and he rejected God because he became envious and decided to build a new kingdom for himself and to become mightier than God. So he rebelled against God and turned many angels on his side, and because of that they were cast out of heaven. From this point we call Lucifer Satan, which means enemy, because obviously he became the enemy of our Father, and therefore he became our enemy as well. So after God had created the earth and the people, Satan decided to build up his mighty kingdom on the earth. And he wanted it to be just like the kingdom of God in heaven, because he always wanted to be like God ever since his heart was lifted up. So basically this idea that he wants to rise above God and make a mighty kingdom for himself, this idea was the foundation of the New World Order, which we can see today. So Satan went down to earth and successfully tempted Adam and Eve, and with the sin they have committed, they separated themselves from God. This was just what the devil wanted, because this way he could enslave the people to himself to build up his new world order, his new kingdom. So he tempted Adam and Eve through the serpent, and Adam and Eve ate from the tree which they were not supposed to eat from, and therefore they became cursed. And after that they wanted to eat from the tree of life as well, but God didn't let them do that, because if that would have happened, they would have lived forever under the judgment. And this is not what God, their loving Father, wanted. So he expelled them from the Garden of Eden. And at this point, the first age of mankind, the age of innocence, ended. From that point, a real battle began between God and Satan, a battle for mankind. God made a plan to save mankind, and Satan made a plan to enslave it and to destroy it after they built up his kingdom. Satan uses human beings, the creations of God, to ruin the old world order on the earth, which is the order of God, and to build up a new world order, which is his new kingdom. And in history, there were numerous attempts to build up a one world kingdom. Of course, God is never going to let that happen. He is never going to let the people build up this new world order, the satanic world order. And in fact, the only reason why he let Satan do what he does on this planet ever since he deceived Adam and Eve is because he let Satan to test his people, whether they really want to follow his son through all the hardships and the struggle, or rather follow the white path, the easy path which leads to hell. And at the same time, the plan of God progressed as well. In fact, his plan always progressed, and it was always successful. From the outside, it looked like the plan of Satan was successful as well, but in fact, the only reason for that is because God let that happen, and he even used the plan of Satan to progress his salvation plan. Just like in the case of Christ, when the devil killed Christ, and he thought he won because he killed the Son of God, but he didn't know that the pain, the torture, and the death of the Son of God was the most important key element of the redemption. So the devil lost that battle as well. So God, our loving Father, used his enemy, Satan, to accomplish his divine plan. The same thing is going to happen in the near future, when Satan is going to do his final and greatest attempt to destroy God's old world order and replace it with his new one. Because when Satan is going to start destroying the old world order through his organizations and financed armies, when this is going to happen, many people among destruction and war, many false Christians and many false Jews will wake up and realize that the reason why God doesn't help them is because the only way to approach him is by obedience to his son, and not by false traditions or paying the tithe and supporting the Antichrist and the Freemasons who will build up the false third temple. But let's carry on with the story of mankind. So, at that time, the earth was full of disobedient people and idolatrous cultures and nations, and none of the people were obedient, and they didn't know God, except for some people like Noah who walked with God. And he became an ordained man of God, which the Hebrew language calls Elohim. And from now on, we're going to use this term. So Noah became an Elohim of God, and God called the people out of the idolatrous godless society through Noah. But none of the people came out, and when God destroyed mankind with the flood, because it became so wicked, he only left Noah and his family. And God repopulated the whole earth using only them. And there, with the flood, the second age of humanity ended, which was the age of conscience. So, throughout history, God always found obedient people like Noah, and he used these obedient people to accomplish his plan. And by the way, what's so amazing to me is that, contrary to Satan, God doesn't need legions of people to accomplish his plan. He uses very few, but well-trained, humble, and obedient servants who are trained by him, and their faithfulness to God is hardened by a lot of trials. From these trained people, God uses one person here and another there, and his plan is accomplished. Amazing. Of course, Satan didn't give up yet. He continued to tempt people to sin, just as he tempted Ham, the son of Noah, to make fun of his father, or as he tempted Nimrod, who became the first world leader. And with Nimrod, Satan managed to turn most of the people on his side and decided to build a new world order. So in the chronology of the Bible, the first direct attempt for a new world order was the Tower of Babel. Now, it is important to note that Satan couldn't build up this new world kingdom, this new world order, on his own. So he always has to fool someone to build up that kingdom for him. So he fooled Nimrod and he promised him everything if he builds up his new world order. But by the way, he did the same thing with Yeshua as well. Do you remember when he tempted him when Yeshua was in the desert? The only difference was that Nimrod, he fell in his trap, unlike the Son of God. So Nimrod fell in his trap and accepted his offer and did what he asked him to do. So Satan decided that he will use that man as the leader and the chief architect of that new world order, that new kingdom. Nimrod decided to build up a tower which will be the center of this new world. But there was a problem. He couldn't build it up on his own, so he had to use the same technique that Satan used. He had to fool the people with something in order to enslave them to build up that tower. So, with the help of the devil, he made them believe that there are dangers on this planet from which they have to protect themselves. And the only person who can protect them is he, Nimrod. So, because he was a mighty hunter, and so the people believed him and accepted his order and paid the tax and bowed down and served him and started building the tower. Satan thought that this is it. He won because the people are serving him and not God. So, what happened, as we can read in the Bible, is that the people nearly completed the tower, which would have been the center of the new world. And then God came into the picture and flicked that half-completed new world order with his little finger and it collapsed. He just confused the languages of the people. He only did that. So they didn't understand each other and couldn't continue building the tower. Satan lost that battle. The reason why God did that is because he is a loving father who wants to save humanity at all costs. And therefore, he's never going to let the devil completely take control over mankind. And here, the age of human government ended. But of course, the devil didn't give up. He attempted to build up that new world order again and again, and we will talk about that later. On that note, I would like to mention that ever since the beginning, Satan made the people disobedient to God through idolatry and pagan religions. And with that, he created enmity between God and the people because of the disobedience. But still, God always found obedient people and accomplished everything he wanted through these few people. And he found Abraham, and now we got to one of the most important parts of this recording. Because Abraham is a very, very important figure from the aspect of the spiritual Israel, which was created by God through his son when he sent him down on this earth. Abraham, or as he was called back then, Abram, was the descendant of Shem, a godly man who got bored of the idols, hated them, and turned to God. And God called him and told him to leave the house of his father. And Abraham followed God in total obedience up to the point where he could sacrifice even his own beloved son. He has to be a good example for all the men in the Ecclesia because of his obedience. And with that obedience, he resolved the enmity between God and the people. The enmity turned into a friendly relationship. This is why the scripture says that Abraham was the friend of God. In fact, the correct translation would be something like, there became a friendly relationship between God and the people. Friendship was concluded between God and the people, and the key element of this friendship was his own son's sacrifice. Because the scripture says, and all the things are of God, who had reconciled us to himself by Jesus Christ and had given to us the ministry of reconciliation. In Christ, God was reconciling the world to himself, not counting their trespasses against them, and entrusting to us the message of reconciliation. Ephesians 2:16, and might reconcile us both to God in one body through the cross, thereby killing the hostility. And he came and preached peace to you who were far off and peace to those who were near. So, and you can only enjoy this friendship that he made That is, you can only avoid the judgment if you enter the covenant of God, which he made through his son, Yeshua, who was the Messiah. So Abraham was the symbol for the Messiah. Abraham and his wife were the early symbols of the obedience. So God made a covenant with Abraham because of his obedience and named him Abraham. This was the ordainment of Abraham. Abraham became the ordained prophet of God, the Elohim of God. And it is very important to mention that he also became the symbolic father of the obedient people, as we can see in the New Testament, the symbolic father of the Ecclesia, or we can call it the bride, or the daughter of Zion, or the heavenly Jerusalem. These are all symbolic images for it. This is a community of those who are obedient to God. The covenant of Zion, which is being symbolized by Mount Sion, is the covenant of obedience. And also important to know that Abraham and Noah and all the godly people of the Old Testament were already in this covenant, because they realized that a Messiah will come who will pay the ransom for all their sins, and therefore they also realized that God loves them and wants to save them from his own righteous anger. So this thankfulness is the key element of the obedience which we have to show to God. And these men, they were not afraid of the anger of God because of their sins. They were rather thankful to him. This way, they could be obedient. Because you can only be obedient to God if you're not afraid of him. But don't get me wrong, you still have to show respect to him, like as if you would show respect to your king. However, being afraid of him is just going to cause you to make mistakes. But if you love him, like if he would be your father, you will be able to obey what he says. So, for example, the people of Israel, they tried to be obedient because of the fear with which they looked at God. I mean, they looked at God like as if he would be some kind of relentless ruler or dictator. And this is why they always rebelled against him, because they didn't love him at all. So, back to Abraham. Abraham was the symbolic father of us, the people of the Ecclesia. And he has to be a good example for all the men in the Ecclesia. And Abraham also had a wife, Sarah, who was obedient to God because she was obedient to her husband, Abraham. Just like Abraham has to be a good example for all the men who belong to the Ecclesia, like I said, Sarah has to be a good example for all the women in the Ecclesia. Because the women can only be obedient to God if they are obedient to their husbands. So women, don't let this word fool you. The way they show you to behave on TV is not the way you have to behave if you want to show respect and to be obedient to God. Because the godly women in the Bible always humble themselves before godly men, and especially before their husbands. And needless to say, they loved their husbands and they were always obedient to him. So this is how women should behave. But of course, men have to love their wives as well. Like the way Christ loves the Ecclesia, or the way Abraham loves Sarah. But more importantly, if you look at the godly men in the Bible, they were men. I mean, when they said something to their wives, they said that with authority. They led their wives, and they were the head of the family. The way they show us men to behave, especially on the TV, is, again, not the way we have to behave. How can we expect our wives to respect us and to be obedient to us if we don't talk and act with authority? How can we expect our wives to feel secure with us if we can't lead them? How can we expect our wives to love us if we treat them like a piece of garbage? We have to treat them like God treated us. And the problem is that the word tells us exactly the opposite. So again, according to the scripture, Sarah is the symbolic mother of the obedient people. So she is our symbolic mother, and Abraham is our symbolic father. But don't misunderstand me, this is not Abraham or Sarah worship like the Saint Mary worship in the Catholic Church. This is actually written in the Bible. So Abraham was told to go to the land of the Canaanites, which later became the country of the physical Israel. And he was obedient, and he went to that land, and there God said that he will give that land to his seed. In other words, seed is not in plural. This has a significant meaning because it means that God didn't refer to the physical seeds of Abraham, to the people of Israel, but he referred to the only seed, who is Christ, who created the Ecclesia, the spiritual Israel. This is all written in Galatians, as you can see on the screen. So after that, Sarah and Abraham wanted children, but they didn't succeed. And Sarah was afraid that she is not going to have children. And she made a mistake and asked Abraham to lie with her servant Hagar. Abraham did, and Hagar conceived and bore Ishmael. And after that, Sarah conceived as well and bore Isaac. So as you can see, this is why Christ always said that we should not be afraid, because when we are afraid, we make mistakes. Now, as you can see, because of that mistake, the first child was not legitimate in the eyes of God, and therefore he didn't inherit. Because God said, "Cast out the slave woman and her son, for the son of the slave woman shall not inherit with the son of the free woman." Here God referred to the Jews who served him like Hagar served Abraham. Because Hagar never loved Abraham, and she also mocked Sarah because she couldn't bear children. So this is an allegory for the Jews who served God because they were afraid of him and they didn't love him either. Therefore, Hagar became the symbol of the covenant of slavery, which was made at Mount Sinai when God gave all the laws and the commandments to the Jews. But Sarah became the symbol of the heavenly Jerusalem because she was free and she loved her husband, and she was also obedient. It's important to know that after Hagar and her son were sent away by Abraham, the story did not end yet. Because Ishmael was also blessed by God because he was also from Abraham. And many times in the Bible, his figure returns. For example, Joseph was saved by a company of Ishmaelites. Or another example, when Esau's mother died, Esau was sad and he sent away his idolatrous godless wives, who hated his mother, Rebekah, and took wives from among the daughters of Ishmael. And there are examples from our modern day history too. For example, the Arabian nations, who are the descendants of Ishmael, were the first who came up with the idea that these Jews are not Semi-Jews, but they are from Ashkenaz. So, again, Abraham had to send away the slave woman and her son, and God said that the son of the slave woman shall not inherit. This is a reference to the Jews. The Jews were servants because they got their covenant from servants, from angels, on Mount Sinai. But the obedient people got their covenant from Christ, who was free, because he is the Son of God. And through Christ, God adopted us as his children. And like I said, Abraham was the symbolic father of the obedient people. The Jews were not obedient, so Abraham was not their father, like it says in Romans 9:7, when it says that not all are children of Abraham because they are his offspring. The majority of the Jews were not the children of Abraham because they were not obedient. So let's get back to the actual story of Abraham. After he bore his son Isaac, God tested him, like the scripture says, and told him to go to Mount Moriah. This mountain is one of the other key elements of this recording, because Mount Moriah is the Mount of Sion, and the whole mountain of Sion has a symbolic meaning in the Bible, and it is very significant as well. For example, the city of Jerusalem was built upon that mountain, and also Christ always went up there to pray every morning and evening, and he was also sacrificed there. And also, when Abraham arrived to that mountain, God asked him to sacrifice his son for him on top of it. And Abraham was obedient and did what God asked him to do. But eventually, he didn't have to do it. Unlike a father who really had to sacrifice his son for our sins on that exact same mount. God later told Abraham that he will make him a great nation, but also told him that his sons will be held as captives in Egypt for 400 years. After that, he died, and his son Isaac lived on and bore Jacob and Esau. Satan successfully tempted Esau when he was hungry for food, and he traded his birthright for a bowl of soup. So this was a symbolic image for those people who trade their salvation for the worldly things, because the birthright was a symbol of salvation in the Old Testament. By the way, this is exactly what's going to happen in the near future, when they are going to destroy the old world order and start the new one. They will refuse to give food and clothing to those who do not take the mark of the beast. And the people will trade their salvation for food. Because obviously, after you consciously took the mark of the beast, you're going to lose your salvation. Just like Esau, who traded his salvation for food. But Jacob was obedient and walked with God. So God ordained him, and he managed to give the firstborn's blessing to him, and later named him Israel. Because of his obedience, God promised Jacob that he will give that land, which he gave to Abraham and Isaac, to his seed. Again, it does not say seeds, but seed. This is very important because this refers to the Redeemer who created the spiritual Israel. So Jacob was also the symbolic father of the spiritual Israel. After that, he bore 12 sons who later became the 12 tribal chiefs of Israel. And important to mention that only two of these sons were from Rachel, his real wife, whom he loved. And the others were from Leah, his other wife, whom he did not love. And some other sons were from servants, even. This is why most of his sons were so wicked and disobedient. They were murderers who wanted to kill even their own brother, Joseph. And the reason for that is because they were not from Rachel, like I said. If you look at the two sons, Joseph and Benjamin, who were from Jacob's legitimate wife, Rachel, you can see that they were totally different from the other 10 sons. And sadly, these 10 non-legitimate children were the reason why the physical Israel, why the physical Jews, so their descendants became so wicked and disobedient. We will see examples for that. So, he bore 12 sons. And one of these sons, Joseph, was taken to Egypt, where God could use him to prepare a place for the sons of Israel there for the next couple hundred years. So after the place was prepared for them in Egypt by God, Jacob and his sons and the whole family of Jacob went to Egypt during the time of the 7-year famine. And then when Jacob was close to his death, he gave his blessings to his sons. And you can see that he didn't say anything good about the sons, who were from Leah and or the servants. And they lived in Egypt for hundreds of years, and they multiplied. Sadly, they learned all the idolatry and godlessness of the Egyptians while they were in Egypt. And God raised Moses, who was the first prophet of the Jews, but back then they were just called Hebrews. And a very good example for what I just said, that the physical sons of Jacob were extremely wicked, is that when Moses saw an Egyptian hitting one of his people, a Hebrew, he killed the Egyptian. And on the next day, he saw two Hebrews fighting with each other, and Moses said, "Why do you strike your companion?" And then the guy said, "Who made you a prince and a judge over us? Do you mean to kill me as you killed the Egyptian?" You see, this is how wicked they were, because this means that the guy who was saved by him, because he was the only one who saw that he killed the Egyptian, gave him away. And it goes further. In the next couple of days, even the Pharaoh heard of it, which means that the Hebrews even gave Moses away to the Egyptians. You see, they were in slavery, and instead of trying to cleanse themselves and turn to God, they gave away the man of God. This is how wicked they were. But Moses, he was obedient to God. He came out of the Egyptian idolatry and godlessness and purified himself in the desert of Midian, where he lived for 40 years. God ordained him, and his mission was, with the help of God, to lead the people out of Egypt, the land of slavery. So Moses was obedient and did what God said. After that, Moses and the Jews wandered in the desert for 40 years, because during those 40 years, God wanted to prepare them for the Messiah and cleanse them of everything they learned in Egypt, just like he cleansed Moses, who was also in the desert for 40 years. But in the case of the Jews, that didn't happen, because they were so disobedient and wicked that God could not prepare them for the Messiah. And this is why he gave them the law and the covenant on Mount Sinai. And now we got to one of the other important subjects. Mount Sinai. Mount Sinai was a real mountain, but it was also a symbolic image for slavery, because at Mount Sinai, Like I said, God gave them the law. And the reason why he did that is because the Jews didn't love him, didn't want to serve him, but they served him because they were afraid. But of course, this way they were not able to be obedient because they always made mistakes. They acted just like Hagar, who was the servant of Abraham. And this is why God gave them all the laws and the commandments. But in fact, it was not given directly by God, but through an angel, a servant. Because God will never come down on this earth in his glorious form. Because if he would do that, everything would burn up on this planet because of its filthiness that is in our world. So he sent one of his angels to Moses on top of Mount Sinai. And that angel gave all the laws and the commandments to the Jews through Moses. You can see the verses for that on the screen. Now, it is more important that the law, which was given to them on Mount Sinai, was serving as a guardian for the Jews. Or as the KJV version says, a schoolmaster. So it was a guardian for them until Christ came. Like the following passage says, Galatians chapter 3, verse 24. It says, the law was our guardian until Christ came in order that we might be justified by obedience. Now, I guess you notice that many times when the Bible says faith, I translate it to obedience. And the reason for that is because many times when it says faith, the original translation is not correct. And even when it is, people misunderstand it, because the word faith, in our days, it means that you believe in something. But in fact, what the Apostle Paul meant by faith was that you have to trust the person you believe in and also hearken to his word and therefore obey what he says. For example, it's not enough to just believe that Christ was the Savior. You have to hearken to his word and be obedient to him. So let me read a passage for that. First book of John, chapter 2. He is the propitiation for our sins, and not for ours only, but also for the sins of the whole world. And by this we know that we have come to know him, if we keep his commandments. Whoever says, I know him, but does not keep his commandments, is a liar. And the truth is not in him, but whoever keeps his word, in him truly the love of God is perfected. By this we may know that we are in him. Whoever says he abides in him ought to walk in the same way in which he walked. So, it means that we have to be obedient to Christ, which means that we have to be obedient to the Father. So, let's get back to the law. After God gave them the law, they entered the promised land. God commanded them to eliminate each and every idolatrous, godless nation that was there. But of course, they didn't obey as usual and left some nations. However, this was not the will of God. And they also started asking for a king because the surrounding nations had kings. But this was also not the will of God. And they continued to be totally disobedient up to the point where they created stone idols and bowed down before them. And because of their disobedience, God punished them, and they were always taken by other nations who held them as captives. But on top of all that, the Jews, instead of trying to purify themselves in these captivities, instead, they learned all the idolatry of the nations which held them as captives. And God was tired of them. And after the Babylonian captivity, he didn't let all the tribes return, only two. And because from that point, only two tribes remained, they couldn't exist as a nation, legitimately in the eyes of God. But still, God let them live on because, like the scripture says, the Lord is slow to anger. And also because with the physical Israel, God wanted to statue a bad example for the spiritual Israel to show them how not to behave as an Elohim. But finally, after centuries of struggle with the physical Israelites because of their wickedness and disobedience, he finally decided to destroy Israel because it was totally disobedient and useless. But first, he only destroyed their rabbinic social structure, which was built on the pyramid system which they brought from Babylon. And because he was merciful with them, he decided to first call the people out of this Babylonian system. And he first called the people out through John the Baptist, and then he sent his own son to call the people out of that social system. As you can see, because God is merciful, he always calls the people out of the actual system or society or nation that he wants to destroy. Just like in the case of Noah, who wanted to save people and take them into the ark with him, but none of the people believed him. Or in the case of Moses, who led the people out of Egypt, or in the case of Lot, who was called out of Sodom by the angels of God before they utterly destroyed the city. Or in our case, when God calls the people out of this Babylonian world and religions, which will be soon be destroyed by God. So, through his son, he created the spiritual Israel, the Ecclesia, which consists of the people who came out of the world, or the false religious systems. And we are talking about all the people, including the nations as well, not only the Jews. And finally, after that, God sent in the Romans and destroyed the physical Israel. And that's it. It was utterly destroyed. The stone temple was destroyed as well. And there the story ended. Israel was no longer existent. Not one stone was left upon another, as Christ said. Only the spiritual Israel remained, and it lived on. And here the age of the law ended, and the age of grace began, which we are living in right now. So, the spiritual Israel, like I said, remained and lived on. And it lives on until today. And everyone who joins the spiritual Israel and starts living a Christ-following lifestyle and obeys what the Son of God said and commanded will have eternal life, simply because of the sacrifice of the Son of God. Because with his sacrifice, he made us perfect in the eyes of God, as long as we intend to be obedient. God knows that we will never be able to perfectly obey what he commanded, but this is why his son's sacrifice was needed, because of our sins. So, the spiritual Israel is the spiritual Sion, what the Mount of Sion symbolizes. Or we can also call it the heavenly Jerusalem, or the Ecclesia, or the Bride, but strictly, just in a symbolic sense, we will not dress up in wedding dresses and go before Christ to marry him, because this is what many people think of when they hear the word bride. And this is because many people are still thinking so physically. Like the Pharisees who accepted Christ to come with a great army of angels and everything. And they were surprised when they saw him as a normal, simple man who was more concerned about the poor people than the rich ones. And they didn't believe him. We don't want to become like them, and therefore we have to learn not to imagine everything physically, because with our limited human imagination, we can't physically imagine the things of God. We might be able to understand them, but we cannot physically imagine them. So, let's get back to the timeline. At around the time of the destruction of Israel, Satan also gathered all his best servants, and these people formed secret occult societies. And they served the devil with all their heart and soul. Satan gave power to these secret societies to control empires and religions and all the worldly organizations from the background. This is not just a fairy tale I made up. Look it up anywhere. Read some books. You will know what I'm talking about. In the meantime, the spiritual Israel did its work, grew in number, and fulfilled its duty as Israel, which means that it helped the people of the earth to receive the grace of God, unlike the physical Israel, which did not fulfill this duty because of the disobedience of his people. Of course, Satan did not give up on his plan to deceive all the people and to destroy the work of God and to hinder his plan. So he decided to create a false Christianity to deceive those who want to follow Christ. So he created a Catholic Church through his secret societies. And at the same time, the followers of Christ were being pursued for what they saw and what they believed. They had to flee from their pursuers and hide in caves and catacombs. Their pursuers, the members of the false Christian movement, offered them a deal that if they accept the Pope and all the fancy pagan and satanic traditions of this pseudo-Christian religious world organization, which is called the Catholic Church, they will not kill them. That's what they said. Some of them accepted it, but not all of them. And these true Christ-following people lived on and continued to practice real Christianity and real obedience to God. God did his work through these people. At that time, the Catholic Church took all the original Bibles from the people and rewrote them and falsified them so that later they can prove false doctrine from those falsified Bibles. A couple hundred years passed, most of the followers of the pseudo-Christian movement, so the Catholic Church, most of these people got bored of the idolatry and everything that they practiced in the Catholic Church, and they realized that all these symbols, traditions, and pagan occult practices are not biblical at all. And these people came out of the church and they grew in number. Satan became desperate and wanted to find a solution to keep all the people, to keep all of them disobedient to God, just like they were until then. So he had to find a way for that, and he did. Through his secret societies, like the Rosicrucians and some people like Calvin or Luther, he created new, small, Protestant-looking churches, which were seemingly Protestant because they rejected all the fancy traditions of the Catholic Church. However, they still kept the people in disobedience to God because of the false, biblical-looking teachings and doctrines that, like being filled with the Holy Ghost, or the doctrine of the Holy Trinity. And they still used pagan, satanic symbols like the cross or the Luther rose, which is in fact an upside-down pentagram, and it is also a Rosicrucian symbol. And by the way, Luther and Calvin were connected to the Rosicrucians as well. So the people joined these Protestant-looking movements, but after another couple hundred years, some people were not too lazy to actually open the Bible and start reading it instead of just listening to the pastor. And they realized that these doctrines and teachings, what they have been taught in their Protestant and Reformed churches, these have nothing to do with the real teachings of God, because they are taught from falsified Bible versions. These people came out of the Protestant-looking churches and they grew in number, and Satan was in desperate again, and he had to work something out to keep the people enslaved. And he did again. Through the Jesuits and all the other secret elite organizations and the Catholic Church, Satan created new, even more Protestant-looking churches in America, and the people believed that these new churches are the answer because they are from America, the land of the free, the land of the new ideas and everything. They didn't realize that that these American churches are created by the same organizations who created the previous Protestant-looking churches and the Catholic Church as well. So they fell in their trap again and remained in disobedience to God. So we finally arrived to the present. Now, in our days, people are starting to realize that these new churches, along with the Protestant-looking churches and the Catholic Church, are all from the devil, and they serve two purposes. One is to keep the people enslaved and in disobedience to God, but the other is to support Zionism, the movement which is in fact the ultimate cover for the purely wicked, malicious idea of Lucifer, which he made up back then when he was in heaven, in the presence of God. And now we got to the most important part of this recording, because now we can talk about Zionism itself. So Zionism has nothing to do with God, and especially not with the prophecies of the Old Testament, as we probably understand by now. Zionism is a movement created by the devil to cover up the real plan behind it, because the non-public plan of the elite is to create a new world order where the people will have no choice but to worship Satan just like them, and to bow down and obediently do what they say like slaves. This is their plan, which is thousands of years old. But in order to initiate this new world order, first they have to prepare it. And this is what 90% of their plan is all about, preparing the world for a new world order. A part of this preparation was the act of buying the Palestinians' land from Arthur Balfour, who was the Foreign Secretary of the United Kingdom at that time. The one who bought it from the kingdom was Baron Rothschild, who was an Illuminist. Moreover, the Rothschild family is the head of the 13 Illuminati families, and they work hand in hand with the Jesuits and all the other major secret societies. And now I would like to expose another very important false theory that have spread among the people. And this is the theory which says that the reason why they bought Israel is because the Rothschilds needed a state in the Middle East from where they can control the oil movement of the whole world. And all the wars in the Middle East are about the oil. You probably know the people who are saying it's all about the oil. Well, maybe, but not primarily. because primarily it's about the plan of the Jesuits and all the other secret satanic occult societies. Primarily it's about setting up a home not for the Jews, but for the Antichrist. And now we're going to expose something that not too many people know, and many people know it incorrectly. So what these Satanist secret families and societies did is that they decided to make a false Israel, get false Jews, and try to make the whole world believe that what they do is actually a charitable act because they want a national home for the Jews. And for the Christians, they further explained it because they explained this whole gathering of the Jews theology into the prophecies of the Bible. Even though the prophecies are not about the gathering of the physical Jews, which was utterly destroyed by God forever, but it's about the gathering of the members of the spiritual Israel. But why do they want the people to believe that what they do is actually for the greater good? And the answer is simple, because they want you to support them. They need your money. But you might ask, why? Why do they need our money? Because what they are about to build up right before our eyes, so the New World Order and the Satanic Third Temple, these are both enormous projects, and they require a lot of money and propaganda. And this is what they need our money for, to make you accept their system and to be a slave to their master, which is Lucifer. And all the taxes and everything you pay go into this project as well. So this is what they're planning to do, to build up a New World Order and in the middle of it a Satanic Third Temple for devil worship. You would not support them if you would hear that from their own mouths, right? Believe me, you will, but let it not be too late. Because by the time they're going to admit what they really do and throw away the covers which they used to make you believe what you believe, by that time you're going to be their slave if you have chosen to accept their New World Order and have taken their mark, the mark of the beast, whatever it's going to be. So now we talked about what they are planning to do, and now let's see what they have actually accomplished so far. First, these elite secret societies, with the help of their allied empires and nations, forced the Khazar Empire to convert to Judaism. They forced the Khazars to learn the Hebrew language and to learn and practice all the traditions of the Jews. Unfortunately, they didn't learn the traditions of the honest, humble Jews who respected the Torah of Moses, but the traditions and beliefs of the Talmudic Pharisees. And after a decent time have passed, these Khazars learned all the Hebrew traditions and the Hebrew language, and they started calling themselves Jews. After another couple hundred years, most of these false Khazar Jews moved to Germany and to England and to other European countries. And before the elite started the Second World War, they first bought the land, or what we call Israel now, which means they bought a part of the Palestinian-controlled land from Artur Balfour. And during the Second World War, the Illuminati elite forced the Khazar Jews to escape Europe and occupy the land of the Palestinians. Hitler and Theodor Herzl were the key people in this whole project. Hitler and his regime persecuted the Khazar Jews, and Theodor Herzl started to propagate that these poor persecuted people need a home. And with that propaganda, they made the people believe that forcing the Palestinians out of their land was a totally justifiable act. And this is what we call Zionism. They say that Theodor Herzl was the father of Zionism, and in fact, Hitler and Herzl worked hand in hand with each other because they were part of the same elite organization. So, after the Second World War, the elite created the State of Israel and started to propagate it through the media and through the religious organizations as well, in order to get support. So be advised, all these new churches along with the old historical ones are supporting Zionism. Some of these churches admit it, some of them don't, but they are still supporting the movement of the devil. And so we are here today, and they are about to start building the Third Temple, which will be one of the final steps in the preparing of the New World Order. So this is what they achieved so far, and believe me, they will take it further. So it looks like the plan of the devil got to its final part, but they will take it further, and you wouldn't believe how far they will actually go. The next step in their plan is to create chaos and wars and poverty. This is how they want to ruin the old world order, and the reason for that is that they believe that if they create tribulations in the civilized world and wars and poverty for years, then the people are going to get tired of it, and when they will offer them their new world order as an alternative.
A new world order.
There's a need for a new world order.
Create a new world order.
We needed a new world order.
To build a new world order.
When really a new world order can be created.
A new world is emerging.
A new world order.
I don't care what anybody says about the new world order.
Into the creation of a new world order. Financial world order.
Nell'edificazione di un nuovo ordine mondiale.
In the new world order.
So, the people are going to accept it more easily. Because by that time, after years of war and starving, the people are going to be like animals, and they are going to have one thing in mind: to stay alive. And if the new worlders are going to offer them food and shelter, they're going to do whatever they ask in exchange for the things that they will give them. They are going to take the mark of the beast, whatever it's going to be. And they're going to serve any kind of master that they have to in order to depend on their supplies. And this way, they will accept the Antichrist too. At least most of the people. But we don't want to become one of them. This is why we're going to have to prepare to spend those few years in the wilderness far away from the people in order to avoid conflict with them. Because obviously, we don't want conflict. The first thing we have to do is avoid. So if you don't have the money to prepare, it's a good idea to at least learn basic wilderness survival skills. Because if we're going to have to break away from the sick society at one point, at least we're not going to feel totally lost when we move to the forests. And of course, I believe that God is going to be able to use those skills and the tools that we have in his work at that time, just like he uses it right now. At least that's what I think. But even if I'm wrong, it's never a bad idea to prepare within reason. So that's about preparedness. So they are now uniting the world in all possible ways. They are going to unite all the religions to make a one world religion. And the same way they are going to unite all the governments of the beast and make a one world government. After that, or before that, they are going to build up the false third temple of the Antichrist. And when it's completed, the false prophet will make the first sacrifice there to mimic what Moses did when he consecrated the tabernacle. So they are going to send down fire from the sky with some advanced technology. Again, to mimic what happened at the tabernacle when Moses offered the first sacrifice. And then the false prophet will anoint the Antichrist, just like the prophets anointed the kings in the Old Testament. And there, when the Antichrist will be anointed, the age of grace is going to end, and the new human age will begin, which is the age of the Antichrist, which will last for only 7 years according to the Bible, but it's going to be extremely tough. So the Antichrist will rule for 7 years, and during those 7 years we are going to be persecuted, and they will kill many of us who are trying to be obedient to Christ. But in fact, they will kill anyone who was ever in connection with Christianity, because every Christian will be a potential threat to them, even if that person is just a false Christian who does not really follow Christ. This is why we're going to have to hide in order to survive. And then the great tribulation will come. And at the end of it, the rapture. The rapture will not happen before the great tribulation. This is a lie and a false teaching. The Bible says it's going to happen after all the hardships and before the last trumpet. And there the first resurrection is also going to happen. And then the age of 1,000 years are going to begin, when Yeshua will come down to earth again and rule for 1,000 years. And during that 1,000 years, you are going to have to celebrate only one feast, which will be the Feast of the Tabernacles. And at the end of the 1,000 years, the second resurrection is going to happen, when the people will be judged. And this is it. This is how it's going to look like, according to the scriptures. At least that's what we think is going to look like. But of course, it is possible that we are not 100% accurate with regards to the future. And now, I would like to mention that we are not saying that we are the only ones who know the truth. In fact, we never said that, and we're never going to say that, because that's not true. Many people are concerned about these subjects, and many people know it probably better than I do, or probably better than we do with my friends. So don't go away and say that this is a cult or a sect, because we are not saying that we are the only ones who know the truth. Okay, so I hope you enjoyed this recording, and I hope it was informative, and I was able to express some views about this subject in a way that you can understand it, despite my poor language skills. This information is, by the way, very dangerous. This is something they don't want you to know, and especially don't want you to spread it among the people. But we have to, because this is the will of God. Like I said, He's merciful, and He wants to call the people out of these false religious organizations and the worldly organizations as well. So this is why God wants us to spread this information and to expose the deceptions. Now, I would like to also make it clear that we are not anti-Semitic. We don't have any racial prejudices against anyone. We don't want to create hostility between the Christians and the Jews. In fact, the elitists are the ones who want that. Both the Semite and the false Jews are our fellow humans, just like all the other people. We pray for everyone. This kind of racial distinction was only necessary because of the subject of this recording. Otherwise, we don't care whether you're a Khazar Jew, or a Semi Jew, or American, or Canadian, or Asian, or wherever you're from. So, the most important thing is, if you enter the spiritual Israel, the Ecclesia of God, then your eternal life is guaranteed as long as you're obedient and humble. Obey by love, not by fear, and you have a good reason for loving our Father. He gave His Son's life for our sins. How many of us could make such a sacrifice for somebody we love? Keep this in mind and hold on to it when the hard times are coming, and our Father will save you if you let Him do that. Let His grace be with you all the time. Amen. Thank you. gave his son's life for our sins. How many of us could make such a sacrifice for somebody we love? Keep this in mind and hold on to it when the hard times are coming, and our Father will save you if you let him do that. Let his grace be with you all the time. Amen.